To wonder if this offense is ever going to score a touchdown again. They've gone more than 10 quarters now without an offensive touchdown. Cody Skates kicking off with the breeze. And lands about 8 yards deep, and Victor Ike let it pass by without trying to return it. Here's Leslie.
R.C. Slocum said that because they're going with the wind, he's going to try to use that to jump out to a lead right now. And then in the fourth quarter, going against the wind, hope that they can hold him. So that's their plan, to come out as strong as they can offensively right now. As far as the defense, he said they held the edge in time of possession, even though just barely. So their defense is well rested, and he feels comfortable with that, obviously.
As well he should. Texas has just 7 first downs in the first half, and A&M at only 5. Chris Sims, 10 out of 21 for 85 yards. No touchdowns or interceptions. And still no running room for Cedric Benson. No gain on the play. Time now for our Morgan Stanley well-connected storyline. The only touchdown of this game, Tony Jeffrey. Returned a punt that was blocked by Roderick Babers. 23 yards for a score. A&M had just 60 yards of offense in the first half.
And here is where Texas could really use Cedric Benson to help set up some play action pass, because Chris Sims is going into about a 20-25 mile an hour wind, very difficult to get a good throw off.
Sims finds no receiver open and runs out of bounds with a 1 yard gain, chased out by Gerard Penwright and Amon Simon.
You know, Sean, we talked about this yesterday, about the frustration level with Texas A&M on offense, as we see Simon hobble off a little bit. But this defense has never given up, and you made an interesting point. You get no sense that there has been any finger pointing about the offense. They have just continued to come out, play hard, and not worry about what the offense is doing. It's really a testament to R.C. Slocum and his staff.
3 out of 10 on third down are the Longhorns. This is third down and 8. From the 22, opening possession of the second half. Sims with time, throws underneath, short of a first down. Brett Robin belted down at the 28-yard line by Brian Gamble and Sean Weston.
And Chris Sims had Roy Williams down the sideline, but he was going to go to throw the fade a little too late and into this wind. A wise decision by Sims. You throw one up on a long fade into this wind, and if it wobbles at all, you're looking at interception.
Ryan Bradford running away to Mickey Jones, who's standing at the 35-yard line. Into the wind, a pretty good punt. Jones with a flag down. Gets another block. He's across the 50. He's at the Texas 30. O'Trahan, another special teams tackle. There is a flag down back at the A&M 37-yard line.
It's going to be a halo violation, and right now the trainers from Texas are running out to try to look at Mike Jones, a tight end.
Kick pass interference, just to take a pain. Penalty is declined. First down.
You have to give the receiver of the punt a 2-yard radius, and Michael Ungar was within that space on punt coverage.
And watch the block as Jones comes over to the left. This is Jay Brooks right there. How do you do? Releases Jones down the sideline. Jay Brooks coming back after missing almost 5 games. A huge block. There you go. Coming from the left on Mike Jones, who's got his eyes. You have to have your head on a swivel. And unfortunately for Mike Jones, that looked like a helmet-to-helmet hit. Wouldn't imagine he's feeling too good right about now. That was a great hit by Jay Brooks.
Mike Jones is a senior from San Antonio. A starter at tight end in the past until he tore an ACL last season. He does play in a number of 2 tight end sets. It's a 36-yard punt, a 37-yard return, longest of his career for Mickey Jones. ABC Sports presentation of college football is brought to you by Chevy Trucks, the most dependable, longest-lasting trucks on the road. By Pacific Life Annuities, Insurance, Investments, discover the power of Pacific Life. By Sears, only Sears has the brands you want at the prices you need. Sears, where else? and by Chili's Baby Back Rib, flame grilled and double basted with barbecue sauce.
Sean, you mentioned earlier that Jay Brooks' nickname is Big Play Jay. He's got 5 punt blocks in his career. And although this doesn't go down as a statistic, this does a lot of things. First of all, it releases the punt returner so he gets more yardage, but also it gives some momentum to Texas A&M. That was over on Texas A&M's sideline. Maybe breathe a little life into this offense.
And that has been lifeless for 2.5 games now. Great field position at the Longhorn 27. Quick pass. That's a lateral. Greg Porter wants to throw it back to Ferris, and they weren't fooled. Kalen Thornton throws the play for a loss. Well, the Longhorns said this week when we spoke with their coaches on defense, they had to be very aware for trick plays. They expected a few of them, and here's one.
And this play right from the start, Sean, you just had a feeling something was coming, and Kalen Thornton does a great job. The backside defensive end, play that far away, teach him to get upfield, stay as deep as the deepest offensive player, which that time was Ferris. And we said at the outset, they've got to sniff it out. That was a great job of Thornton sniffing out that throwback.
Now they're going to have to burn the timeout because they couldn't get the play in from the sideline. Second down and 16 upcoming for Mark Ferris and the Aggies.
After the new Chevy Trailblazer, everything else just seems kind of weak. The all-new 270 horsepower Chevy Trailblazer, like a rock.
Ain't this the perfect specimen of a man?
Inside the ring, he was the greatest. Outside.
Do you think you're acting like the people's champion?
I ain't gonna be the champ the way you want me to be the champ. I'm gonna be the champ the way I want to be.
He was even more.
We're going from the darkness to the light.
Will Smith is.
I'm gonna hit your hand 6 times before you get to 3. Go.
1, 2, 3.
Did I hurt you?
Ali, this film is not yet rated. Opens everywhere Christmas Day.
So Denver doesn't win a Super Bowl till long after Tommy's retired.
And the Packers. I mean, they couldn't win one until Sterling hung them up.
I don't think it's really a coincidence. It's just my thought. I don't know. I mean, you won a Super Bowl.
It's not that hard.
Hey, Boomer.
Sterling.
Burger's ready.
Great. I've been looking forward to this.
There you go.
NFL Countdown, Sundays, 11 a.m. Eastern on ESPN.
Look, we got a lot to do today, so let's make this quick. Get what you need. We're out of here. Agreed?
Yes.
Kevin!
We know how you feel, and that's why you can shop online and pick up at a nearby store the same day, or we'll ship to you. Circuit City, we're with you.
I think that went really well.
There's nothing more dangerous.
He says a cop did it.
Than a criminal with a badge.
Where is the shield?
I don't know.
New NYPD Blue, ABC this Tuesday, 9, 8 Central.
After the A&M timeout, second down for the Aggies. Good throw by Ferris. Terrence Murphy with the catch. Then he slipped down as he turned toward the first down marker. Second catch for Murphy. He fell down about 5 yards short of the first down. It'll be third down and 5 from the 22. That's one of the few confident-looking throws we've seen from Ferris the last couple of weeks. Today's first and 10 line is brought to you by Chevy Trucks.
And as R.C. Slocum told Leslie Goodell, with this wind at their back, they got a nice break with the punt return, made their own break, actually, and come out, and Terrence Murphy runs a great route. And you're right, Sean, Ferris, with the wind at his back, first time he's really looked confident, released it on time.
Movement along the line, but no flag. Ferris has the ball. Nice catch by Porter. Inside the 10. First down, Aggies. Greg Porter, the two-sport athlete, minor league baseball player, former member of the Aggie baseball squad, and receiver. He's missed 5 games because of a broken foot. Caught the pass from Ferris. Another former minor league baseball player, first in goal, Aggies at the 8.
Greg Porter has the best hands. They say there's nobody who's even close. This ball thrown back across, 6'5", a left-handed stab at it, brought it back to his right hand. Little Gimpy still on that broken foot. He's been limping around, but what a fantastic catch by Greg Porter.
Joseph running left, running hard, running inside the 5 to the 4-yard line. It took both safeties, Ahmad Brooks and then Nathan Vasher, to get him on the ground.
It has been since the fourth quarter of Iowa State, back on October 27th, that A&M has scored. And this is the way they're going to need to do it, Sean. The only thing they've been able to do is run straight ahead. But what a great job by Ahmad Brooks, a guy who came in as a cornerback, now playing safety. A lot better tackler than they expected. A fantastic job by Brooks that time, saving the touchdown.
The pitch to Joseph, following Joe Weber. Touchdown!
Fantastic player, Joe Weber. I know that Keith Joseph will get credit for this touchdown, but a great lead block by Weber. We've seen him catch the ball out of the backfield, run it. He's been special today for A&M.
And Cody Skates just did get the extra point inside that left upright. A 4-yard touchdown run by Joseph. His fourth touchdown of the year. And Texas A&M has tied this one up. The punt return teams providing most of the offense in this game. Texas, a block punt returned for a touchdown, and then a 37-yard punt returned by Mickey Jones. Gave A&M the ball with the Texas 27. They marched down to the 4. Keith Joseph punched it in. First offensive touchdown in more than 10 quarters for the Aggies. Skates kicks it out of the back of the end zone. So again, the Longhorns will start from their own 20.
Can't say enough about this A&M defense, Sean. Obviously having a fantastic outing today, but really, if you go all the way back, they had a couple of early wins against McNeese State and at Wyoming. And R.C. Slocum, who was pretty mild-mannered, came in and really went off on his defense, and they played great ever since.
Those are the numbers we spoke of earlier for Sims in the third quarter last year in Austin against A&M. 8-for-8 for 3 touchdowns, and turned a close game into a rout. Tied at 7 in the third quarter today. First and 10 from the 20. Sims is going to run. Slides head first. Knee down to the 29-yard line. A yard short of the first down as Jay Brooks was approaching the quarterback.
Jay Brooks, one of the guys who was pretty vocal about Chris Sims coming into this season. They talked about the game last year. You just saw the numbers Chris Sims put up in the third quarter. 3 touchdowns, 20 yards to Roy Williams, 55 to Sloan Thomas, and 70 yards to B.J. Johnson. An amazing quarter that really set the stage nationally for Sims as a quarterback and those 3 amazing, at the time, freshman wide receivers.
Jay Brooks said if their starters were healthy in the secondary last year in that game, they would have made the plays against Sims. Sims has actually rushed for more yards now than Benson. 12 yards rushing for Chris on 6 carries. You can flip those numbers for Cedric Benson. 12 carries for 6 yards rushing.
Mike Hankwitz said all week long they'd be willing to leave one-on-one Roy Williams against Sammy Davis and stop this run. It's working out so far.
Benson finds a hole and a first down out to the 34. A 5-yard gain, his longest run of the day. Sean Weston made the tackle. Benson, one of the top recruits in the country, coming out of Midland Lee last year. Rushed more than 8,400 yards in high school. Was a 3-time Texas 5A Offensive Player of the Year as his team went to 3 straight state titles. And after the play, a personal foul penalty signaled by Hal Dowden against Texas. Each team penalized twice today prior to this one.
They had a
dead ball, personal foul against the offense. After the first down, we have a 15-yard penalty, first and 10.
Sean, in a game like this, when things are not going your way, it's an emotional rivalry game. You've got to keep your cool. You're already going against the wind. The momentum is squarely against Mac Brown's team. To do something dumb and get a penalty after a play is unacceptable.
It was after the first down, with first and 10 from the 19-yard line. Sims, with time, throws for the tight end, a diving catch. And what a catch it was out of the 40-yard line. A 21-yard gain on the pass to the sophomore from Denver, Colorado, Bo Scape.
Scape, the third leading receiver, lined up in the tight end, Penright over the top. Penright's dropping off into the flat, and there trailing is Harold Robertson. And even Terrence Keel comes over, but Scape is so good at running away from linebackers. You really have to put a safety on him. And he is a weapon that Texas has put into their offense to take a little pressure off the outside receivers.
Longest play of the day for the Texas offense. Good catch and a low throw by Williams. And he's pushed out by Sammy Davis. Gain to the 45, a pickup of 5.
And because Sammy Davis is lined up one-on-one against Roy Williams, one of the most gifted athletes in college football, Davis playing well off of him. I think it's a good move by Mike Hankwitz. If you're going to go one-on-one against this guy, you might as well give 8 or 10 yards, and if they're going to throw a 5-yard out, let him have it.
The noise ever present. Chris Simpson, when he played here 2 years ago, sometimes as he came up to the line of scrimmage, he was almost mesmerized by the noise and the towels waving everywhere he looked. Benson again gets just 1 yard. Evan Peroni and Terrence Keel combining on the tackle. And another key third down. It'll be 3rd and 4 with 9 minutes left in the third quarter in a tie game.
Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator at Texas, said it's not just the noise that gets you. It's a coordinated noise. Listen how loud they get on this 3rd and 4.
Brent Robin, the lone back. 3 receivers. D.J. Johnson, the motion man. Here comes a blitz. Flag down. And they whistle the play down before the snap. Aggie celebrating. They think there was movement by the horns.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense. 5 yards only. Still 3rd down.
Now you go from a 3rd and 4 to a 3rd and 9, and you start playing into the hands of Mike Hankwitz and some of the things that he can call. He has so many things at his ability. This time, they're showing blitz in the middle. Let's see who. Looked like everybody was statues to me, Sean. I don't know who flinched.
Well, tough to tell who moved from that replay. The referee doubting the offensive backfield who threw the flag. Instead of 3rd and 4, it's 3rd and 9. Sims throws it in the flat for Scape. He has some running to do to get a first down. He lunges. If they give him the ball at the 50-yard line, it's a first down. And it looks like they will spot it right on the yard marker for an apparent first down.
Scape, one of those tight ends. He's not huge, 6'3", 245 pounds. A lot like Trent Smith at Oklahoma. A guy who's not going to be a big bruising blocker, but with Mike Williams and Robbie Doan at your tackles, you don't really need a great blocker at that tight end spot, but an excellent run after the catch. It looked to me Texas A&M had this thing swarmed up as he makes a couple of moves and splits the defenders. Nice job. Botovich came in there.
He got a great spot there, Ed, because it looked like his knee was down. He bounced and then extended the ball, and he just came up short by an inch or two right on the 50-yard line. But his knees were down, and then he bounced forward and stuck the ball out, and they gave him the full extension that came up about 2 inches short, and it looks like the Longhorns are going to go for it on 4th and an inch or two from the 50-yard line.
Matt Brown did this earlier in the game at about the exact same spot. Wouldn't imagine they're going to get too fancy. They ran a quarterback sneak to the left, and with a 225-pound quarterback and 300-pounders in front of you, I'd imagine the same thing.
Oh, movement on the right side of the offensive line. That might change Mack Brown's strategy now. Mike Williams, impossible to miss when he moves. The building shakes.
And there's the coordinated noise of Texas A&M. This is all about get off. A quarterback sneak is all about your defensive line. If they can get a better get off than the offensive line and cause any penetration, taking up the entire bottom of your screen is Mike Williams. But even removed one man from the offensive guard, that much noise on the field, very difficult for Mike Williams to hear the snap.
Mickey Jones back for the punt from Brian Bradford. And the last punt return earlier in this quarter. Jones brought about 37 yards to set up the touchdown. Another decent punt into the wind. Jones hit immediately. Another flag down for another halo violation. Michael Ungar again. Too close. Irvis Hill made the tackle.
There's a lot of coaches in college football, Sean, that are asking that this ruling be looked at. As Ungar comes from the outside, he's being locked up. Even though he's being blocked, his momentum was what took him into Mickey Jones. But a lot of coaches think that this needs to be a bigger penalty because there's really no reason for Ungar to pull off with only a 5-yard penalty.
And they pick up the flag, saying that he was blocked into the halo. R.C. Slocum doesn't like it.
Is down over on the Texas sideline. He took a shot kind of like what Jay Brooks delivered earlier. Blind side, Texas was trying to set up the wall on that side. And as the returner stepped out, Robertson got popped right up near the shoulders.
They're already thin at linebacker. He's been playing a great deal because Jared Morris, the starter, has been in and out of the game. He's been bothered by knee injuries. Sat out most of the game at Oklahoma 2 weeks ago. Good news for Robertson and the Aggies as he's running off. Well, another tight one in this rivalry that dates back to 1894. And part of the Thanksgiving weekend since 1901. In recent years, played on the Friday after Thanksgiving. 60 times they played it on Thanksgiving Day. 108 meeting overall. Only Missouri and Kansas and Minnesota and Wisconsin have met more often on the football field in college football. Sims threw it away over the head of the tight end, Oliver Edward Bo Scape. Oliver Edward Scape the third, and he goes by Bo. You call him whatever he wants you to call him, because he's very active and proficient in the martial arts. And at 6'3", 245, even if he wasn't, you wouldn't be inclined to say much to him anyway.
Well, he was blocked out that time by Mike Williams as we were trying to get a shot at him.
And Williams admits to 360, and a gleam in his eye that would suggest he might even be heavier than that. Great tackle. Sims has it batted down. Brian Gamble. And the junior, mentioned earlier, his dad Lucky, a high school coach, played at Baylor. His mom, the late Kathy Gamble, was a fine basketball player at Baylor. Tragically, she was killed in a car accident a year and a half ago.
Derek Dockery, the left guard, not able to adjust and get out on Brian Gamble. Gamble, a reputed film junkie. That's a blitz where he gets to choose the gap. And with the tackle coming down and the guard popping out, he chooses wisely to go outside the offensive tackle to jump up and knock it down.
Brett Robin, the third down specialist in the backfield. Sims steps up right to the line of scrimmage and airmails Sloan Thomas. He was very close to being across the line when he released that pass.
And he really felt like he had to get a lot on that ball, Sean, with that much wind coming into his face. But when you throw it that low, the wind, when you drive the ball like he did that time, the wind's not going to have as much of an effect. And luckily, he did drive that ball because that was interceptable.
Brian Bradford, the junior from Lufkin, Texas. Transfer from Trinity Valley Junior College. He's also a quarterback. Didn't get all of that one, but did get a favorable bounce. down to the 25-yard line. 26-yard punt. 7-all in the third quarter. The receiver nearest the ball. Gordon and Tubbs putting some heat on Farris.
They're running out of time to take advantage of this wind at their back, and that time Goins ran a post-corner route. Very well defended that time by Babers. And Mark Farris should have come off of that. Babers had outside position. There was no way that Goins was going to be able to get back to the corner route.
I wonder if leg injuries are contagious. I mean, some of these guys look like they come away limping. Yep. After every play, they never had injury problems like this under R.C. Slocum. Joseph forced to bounce it outside, lunges forward for a gain to the 28-yard line. That play picked up three. It'll be third and seven. Ahmad Brooks with another stop. Next Saturday, Hall of Fame running back Gale Sayers is one of football's true legends, and his relationship with teammate Brian Piccolo was legendary. Brian Song. Next Sunday at 7, 6 Central, right here on ABC. Yards of offense for Texas A&M and six first downs, trying to convert them third and seven, and they do. Mickey Jones out to the 49-yard line. He's made the big plays today for A&M, the 37-yard punt return that set up their touchdown, and now a 20-yard gain on third down and seven.
Nice job crossing around with Mickey Jones and Greg Porter. You'll see it unfold right in front of Mark Farris. And Mickey Jones, one of those guys, a senior, who hasn't got a ton of playing time, but the coaches talk about him in the open field. He's not the fastest. He's not the quickest. He doesn't have the best moves. He says hook this to Texas, but he has been really the only bright spot for Texas A&M on offense and, of course, a big return on special teams.
The option, not the specialty of Ferris. He ran it pretty well there. Hits it when he had to Joseph. Keith was tackled by Nathan Vasher, the sophomore from Texarkana.
I wouldn't be surprised if Mickey Jones got the upside-down horns from R.C. Slocum yesterday during the walkthrough. Slocum, who's coached in this game 28 times, he's 16-12, had a hat on that had a longhorn on the front with the horns broken off, and underneath in maroon it said, hook this, so sending a message to his team that he didn't buy into any of it either.
29 times Slocum's been involved in a A&M Texas game. The head coach, or as an assistant, he's 16-12 overall, 7-5 as a head coach. Pass off the mark. Intended for Terrence Thomas. Zachary Pearson had the coverage. It'll be third down.
R.C. Slocum also talked about the talent. You know, it was funny when we did that game earlier in the year, the Texas-Colorado game. Mac Brown said, everyone says it's a bad thing that we have a lot of talent. Well, I can recruit, and I don't think that's necessarily bad, but R.C. said it's kind of scary that that talent is now playing up to its ability late here in the second part of this season. Very frightening when you look at them on film, how many guys they have that can play.
And Coach Slocum also admits the talent level is a little bit down in this program from where it has been in the past. Farris with time with a receiver, but it's a low throw. And Thomas had a lunge for it. That cost them the chance to run for a first down. They'll spot him at the 44 or just inside the 44. They need to get just inside the 42 for a first down.
Not even a choice. Oh, Sean, I think this is the wrong call by R.C. Slocum. He's got the wind in his back. You punt it away. Any kind of time of possession, running the ball by Cedric Benson, anything to eat clock, and then you're into the win for the fourth quarter. I think on the plus side of the field, he should go for it on fourth down.
Well, his offense has been so bad, the defense so good, he'd rather play field position here and lean on the defense. Skates, took a long time to get it off, flags down. They might have hit Skates again, the punt. Downed at the two, but there are two flags down. Chante Buell down the punt.
Sean, they're going to get Wes Bodovich, the personal protector for Cody Skates, for tackling. It looked like Maurice Gordon that he was blocking. Wes Bodovich, a safety, is getting run over. This is a safe look. Mack Brown decides to leave his defense out there, and you turn the defensive linemen loose. Sometimes they don't have the speed to get back there and block it. Watch Podovich right here.
Holding on the kicking team. 10-yard penalty.
It was the right call.
Oh, boy.
But a nice, hey, listen, Podovich, although he gets called for the penalty, if he doesn't block Gordon and take him to the ground, I'm not so sure Gordon doesn't get another block for Texas.
Podovich, the senior from Kennedale, Texas. Started his collegiate career at Texas A&M Kingsville. Was the quarterback there, played well, but was unhappy in the program. Sent around tapes to many schools. He drove all over Texas doing that. Wasn't even going to bother at A&M, thought it was too high a level, but they were driving by the school, so he dropped off a tape, was invited to walk on. Flags before the punt.
And it was Wes Botovich again, this time leaning forward in anticipation
of the snap. False start on the kicking team. 5-yard penalty, still fourth down.
Maybe a little shook after getting run over by Maurice Gordon. He starts leaning forward before the snap. And now that thing that looked like great field position for R.C. Slocum's defense could get a lot better for the University of Texas.
So all of a sudden, the ball back on the A&M 41. The good news is, with the wind, Skates, if he can get it off, should be able to drive it deep into Texas territory. And he does. Basher caught it at the 13. The first man ran by him to avoid the handling fraction, and that hurts. Basher finally tackled from behind at the 36-yard line. 46-yard punt, 23-yard return. Here's Leslie Goodell.
Sean, the American flag can be seen flying prevalently across the United States right now in the wake of the September 11th attack. But there are 55 American flags placed around Kyle Field, representing something much closer to home. 55 servicemen and former Aggies were lost in World War I, and they have put these flags around Kyle Field in a tribute to them. And with the wind blowing the way it is today, you can certainly see them.
First and 10, Texas at the 36. Sims throwing deep into the wind. The ball hung up there in the wind. Sammy Davis caught it out of bounds. As he had excellent coverage on Roy Williams. Williams waging a one-on-one battle all day.
I don't care if you have a cannon strapped to your arm. This is a very difficult throw. Just an absolute fly pattern by Roy Williams. Sammy Davis, an excellent job looking back for the ball the entire time. But there you see the long arms of Roy Williams. That ball stayed in bounds. It was a great play by Jay Brooks to come up with it.
Second and 10. Blitz off the corner, and Sims is sacked. Gerard Penright got him after Christian Rodriguez made him step up. Second sack for Texas A&M.
Mike Hankwitz talked about trying to get Texas into predictable down. Second and 10 is a predictable down. Penright up here working on Doan, the left tackle. Once again, just using that speed, staying alive. It was the pressure in the middle that flushed Sims, and Penright gets his first sack in three ball games.
10.5 sacks for the season now for Penright. Leslie talked about the flags. Penright's fiance, Aisha Thompson, is in the Air Force. She's stationed in England. Penright sends her the tapes every week. Brett Robin carrying on third down and long, a very conservative call. Sammy Davis and Brian Gamble combining on the stop and going into the wind in this defensive battle. The Longhorns didn't want to take any chances. Robin got out to the 42, but they're 4 yards shy of the necessary yardage.
And I think the Texas coaches made the right call there, Sean. You saw how difficult it was for Sims, who threw everything he had into that fly route by Roy Williams and still was not able to get it there. That would have been an awfully long throw to pick up the first down.
Brian Bradford punting to Mickey Jones. High but short. Jones signaled for a fair catch but couldn't get up to the ball through some traffic. And it rolls dead at the 27-yard line. Irvis Hill downed it there. Well, this is just the start of our Thanksgiving feast today. Following our game, number one, Nebraska. And Eric Crouch, the Black Shirts defense, heading to the land where the Buffalo roam to take on the Boulder Brigade for a spot on the Big 12 title game lineup. Bobby Pesavento will start at quarterback for Colorado, so stay tuned to ABC for Nebraska and Colorado coming up next.
After we did that Oklahoma game a couple weeks ago, Sean, I was out after the game and was trying to tell the Oklahoma people they have to root for Nebraska. They want to play the highest rated team in that Big 12 championship game. That's their best chance to end up in the Rose Bowl.
And give the Sooners a chance to avenge their only loss of the year. The only loss of Texas is against Oklahoma. Ferris, lots of time, lousy throw. He had time to set himself and step into a throw and just kind of lazily threw the ball of his back foot well short of Terrence Murphy. Let's check in at Times Square Stadium with John. Well, congratulations to Southern Miss. Big win in Conference USA. Joseph, first down, powering his way out to the 43-yard line. 16 yards on the rush for Keith Joseph. Now 66 yards rushing today for the redshirt freshman on 21 carries.
Watch the left guard Yates pull around here. He's going to get a great seal block to spring Joseph. Instead of kicking him out, he tries to hook the guy down inside, and that was enough for Joseph, who's run very well today, Sean. You get a feeling that he feels like this is his opportunity with Derek Farmer out of the ballgame to showcase how hard he runs.
His longest run of the day, A&M running out of time. They approach a minute left, running out of time with the wind at their backs here in the third quarter. The wind has been a major factor today. Ferris throwing deep with the wind, and it is over the head of Terrence Thomas. Very tight coverage by Roderick Neighbors, but that ball is not catchable inbound.
Dino Babers has been calling a lot of those fades to the outside. We saw post corner earlier. A lot of times it's an easier route for these young receivers to run, but a very difficult throw against Quentin Jammer and Babers, two of the best corners. None of these fade routes has been open for Ferris, and all he can do is throw it to the outside and hope that somebody can make a play.
His teammates call Roderick Babers Stonehands. He just cannot catch the ball, doesn't have any interceptions. Babers says, I have a motto. Nobody catches the ball on my side of the field, not even me. Joseph picking his way out to the 46. We're under a minute left in the third.
You know, we've been talking about this A&M defense, and it's worth noting how good this Texas defense is and how much better it's gotten since Carl Reese was here. When he got here in 98, the year before, they were 96th in the country. He said there was only two problems with the defense when I got here. They were slow and they couldn't hit. Well, he's improved them drastically. And with a good outing today, you would assume they would catch who's second in the NCAA in total yards, Virginia Tech, who has to play Miami next weekend.
Third down, third and seven, flag down, Ferris down, juggling the football, and it comes out. Recovered by Corey Redding. They're going to mark Ferris down before the fumble at the 37, and now the penalty.
It's going to be offsides, I believe, by Texas. So a free play for A&M, luckily for Ferris.
Kalen Thornton appeared to be offside.
Thornton down here on the bottom trying to get a jump, was in the neutral zone. Ferris holding that ball because you might as well try and make a play. If you see the flag come in, you can hold it for just a second longer.
Much more manageable third down now. Third down and two.
And with the last play they have, most likely with the wind at their backs for Texas A&M, this may be a chance to try something down the field. Maybe a play fake. 2 yards running the ball has not been easy today.
We won't get a chance to run another play with the wind. Fourth quarter upcoming in a tie game. Texas 7, Texas A&M 7. ABC Sports presentation of college football will return after this message and a word from our ABC station. Just a tremendous venue for college football. These great fans enjoying another tight Texas A&M game. Big play, first play of the fourth quarter, third and two. Aggies going into the wind now at the Texas 49. Ferris forced to stop, and he did not get the first down. Didn't even get back to the line of scrimmage. A loss of one. Kalen Thornton will be credited with a sack. And Cody Skaich will punt into the wind. And he's had one blocked already today that was run back for the Texas touchdown, and they've come very close to blocking several others.
With his left foot, got ran into earlier in the game in a roughing the punter. It's been really the big play of the game for Texas because of the trouble Skaich has had both with field goals, PATs, and getting the ball off.
Punt mishandled as the Aggies tried to down it. It clanged off Byron Jones, where they will spot the ball at the 19-yard line. ABC Sports presentation of college football is brought to you by Nissan. Nissan driven by Burger King, home of the Whopper, by new Pepsi Twist, Pepsi and Diet Pepsi with a twist of lemon, and by Midas. See Midas for all your car care needs. Midas, we do that.
A game that's gone back and forth with both defenses playing fantastic and special teams being such a big part of it. Now Texas has the advantage, and R.C. Slocum's bunch loses this win.
There's Mike Hankwitz, 31-year coaching veteran. He'll be very proud of the performance of this defense today against one of the best offenses in the nation. Cedric Benson matching his longest run of the day with a 5-yard pickup. Christian Rodriguez chopped him down. We checked the Nissan drive summary for Texas here in the second half. There haven't been any long drives through the countryside for the Longhorns here in the second half.
We were talking about Mike Hankwitz and the job that he's done. He's had some guys banged up himself. He's finally got them healthy with 2 weeks rest, able to rotate guys in, keep them fresh. And the time of possession, not as bad as it had been in the previous three or four ball games for Texas A&M on offense.
Little misdirection. Benson with running room, a first down. Bodovich finally gets him on the ground at the 46-yard line of A&M. 26 yards on the run for Cedric Benson.
Guy who idolizes Ricky Williams, but everybody says that he reminds them more of another guy who's made a great name for himself in the state of Texas, Emmett Smith. Does a great job of jumping over a defender in the hole. But he's quicker than you think he is. He's stronger than you think he is and more elusive. A lot of those things didn't show up as much as Mack Brown says they have shown up lately in games.
Up to 41 yards rushing for Benson. So he's going to need to break a big one to reach the 100 mark for the sixth straight game. He's thrown for a loss on that play. Rocky Bernard made the tackle. Christian Rodriguez forced the play, and Bernard finished him off.
Rodriguez and his mate on the other side in this 3-4 defense, Gerard Penright, who've been playing a lot of defensive end today, as well as outside linebacker. A couple of guys who had to wait their turn with some of the great outside linebackers that they sat behind. Jason Glenn now in the NFL with the Jets, playing fantastic today and have for the entire season.
Second and 12. The Longhorns with the breeze at their backs here in the fourth quarter. Sims zips one incomplete. Flag thrown from the official about 30 yards downfield. Bo Scaife, the intended receiver, and the back judge said that Brian Gamble was making contact over the back before the ball got there.
Take a look as Gamble gets his drop right up there on the left part of your screen.
The official at the top right of your screen who throws the flag from about 35 yards away.
And I don't know what he saw. I know that was a quick look at it, but it didn't look like Gamble ran through Scaife to make that play. Looked like he got his left hand over there to make a really nice play on the ball. That's a long way away to make that call, Sean.
Gives the Longhorns a first down at the 37-yard line. Fifth penalty against A&M. Sims throws to Roy Williams. He's pulled down for a gain of a yard and a half by Sammy Davis. Eighth catch for Williams.
Boy, what
for
Sammy?
Just 55 yards.
Sammy Davis, what a great game he's been playing out there one-on-one with Roy Williams. This is a setup screen. A lineman for Texas is going to come out late. That's zone to left tackle. And Davis stays right on Williams even as he's getting blocked to make that play. And that was one thing that the coaches said Davis had to get better at, was making tackles, and he has improved.
Second and eight. Sims trying to communicate with the lineman with the deafening noise. The blitz, they run into it. And Penright wraps up Cedric Benson. Benson walks slowly with a slight limp, now trots to the sideline with third down upcoming.
And there has been just no room. A couple of runs for Benson today where he's got blocking. This time, Mike Hankwitz takes a little gamble on a running play. If Benson finds a seam in that blitz, but disciplined blitz by the A&M guys who were coming off the edge, they stayed in their gap and gave Benson nowhere to go.
Brett Robin, the lone back. Thomas, Williams, and Johnson, the wide receivers. Third down and just longer than 10. Sims forced to step up. Throws on the run. Incomplete. Will there be a flag on this one? No. Sammy Davis batted it away from Roy Williams.
Well, Sean, Chris Sims said that given the outcome, if the outcome comes up for Texas, that he may have a few words for some of these defensive backs who said we weren't healthy last year. Davis said he was about 65% on a bad ankle. Well, he's not going to have any words for them the way they played today, especially Sammy Davis.
10th punt for Bradford. That's a single game high in his career. Trying to pooch it with the wind at his back. And he does so very nicely. Down to the 8-yard line by Irvis Hill. 10:32 remaining in the fourth quarter. The Horns hooked up with the Aggies and the Dandy. 10:32 remaining in regulation play in College Station, Texas. Texas A&M looking for its eighth win of the year, trying to improve their bowl prospects. Thinking with a win, the Alamo Bowl might be their likeliest destination. On first down from the 8-yard line, a handoff straight ahead to Keith Joseph, and he was taken down by Corey Redding.
At this point, Sean, in this type of game that has gone back and forth and has really now become a battle with the wind and the field position because of the great punt by Texas to pin Texas A&M down inside. I know they want to be conservative and try to get something, but they have to get anything. And they've been a screen team. They've been very effective with screens both to their wide receivers and their running backs. They haven't run a bunch today. You might want to try to slip it in. It's a little easier throw for Mark Ferris.
Play action pass by Ferris. Wobbly pass, and it is caught out of bounds. Incomplete. Nice catch by Terrence Murphy. And he was over with his teammates on the sideline.
Not a conservative throw, a little easier throw to the out route down the field, but it took so long to develop. You had to start getting nervous with the pressure that Texas has had all day. Ferris gets sacked down around the goal line. You're looking at third and long. You don't pick up any yardage. Now your punter, your gimpy punter, Cody Skates, has to get one off in his own end zone.
Admittedly, as an inexperienced cast around him due to all the injuries, but Ferris doesn't seem to be as impressive a thrower as he was last year. His confidence is shaken a bit by all that has transpired. He nearly threw an interception. Hit D.D. Lewis, the middle linebacker, near the 10-yard line. Yeah. And the senior from Houston couldn't hang on to the interception. And it'll be a punt into the wind from the end zone for Cody Skates.
D.D. Lewis, again, that middle linebacker in a 4-3 alignment. Looked like to Ferris that he had Terrence Thomas wide open. It's so hard because you're looking beyond quarterback depth. D.D. Lewis, nice job in his drop.
Longhorn should get great field position. Skates got it off, but Basher catches it on the run at the 40 and is down at the 35-yard line. Tackled by Jonte Buell. 31-yard punt, 6-yard return, still 7-all with 9.5 left. The largest crowd ever to watch a football game in the state of Texas, 87,555. That's about 5,000 over the listed capacity. Jammed into Kyle Field, 7-7 the score. Fourth quarter, Sims going for the lead. Roy Williams couldn't catch it with one hand. Sean Weston had coverage. It's been Sammy Davis matched up with Roy Williams most of the day. That time Weston had one-on-one coverage, and the sophomore from Inglewood, California held up well.
Really nice job by Weston running one-on-one. Gets his eyes back a little bit on the quarterback, but continues to run. He's got the right arm up there, Sean. The official blocked out by Roy Williams, who lands very awkwardly there. Not able to see the arm bar by Sean Weston, but that was good one-on-one coverage.
From the A&M 35. Second and 10. The handoff to Cedric Benson. Gets away. First down inside the 25 to the 23. Respotovich knocked him down. A pickup of 12. 48 yards rushing on 19 carries now for Benson.
This big powerful offensive line, Mike Williams, the right tackle. Great job right there. He just absolutely mauled the left side of that defensive line. And anytime you get that kind of push, they have not had it all day, but Mike Williams, really nice job on the one-on-one block, blowing up the left side of that defense and allowing Benson some room to run.
In a quiet day for Sims, he's thrown for 127 yards. Benson inside the 20 to the 18. Lynn Smith made the stop, but it's five more for Benson.
And you start to see a pattern develop with Texas. Whenever they want to get anything on the ground, they're going to go behind Mike Williams, the right tackle. To me, one of the most gifted offensive tackles in college football. You mentioned his size, 6'6". He claims 360, but Sean, he moves like a 270-pound man. Very gifted athletically. Does not appear fat. He just moves around so well.
Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator, told us Williams is lighter on his feet than Leonard Davis, who was the number two pick in the last NFL draft by Arizona. Benson trying to get outside, and he gets smothered. Managed to get to the 16 for two more. Rod Penwright and Wes Botovich. In on the stop. Last five games. And some less than stellar defenses, obviously. And they've been running up the yardage and the points, averaging 47 points. Today, just 200 yards of offense. Their season average is 425 yards of offense per game and 41 points. Third and three. Sims, with a lot of time, dumps it for Scape, the tight end, first and goal. Scape down at the five, tackled around the ankles by Harold Robertson.
And a nice job by Chris Sims, seeing what the coverage was. It appeared that Roy Williams, who was running a fade into the corner of the end zone, had one-on-one coverage with Sean Weston. He did not. So you come back underneath, knowing that the safety has run out of the middle of the field, and you have Harold Robertson trying to cover Bo Scape one-on-one. That was a nice read by Sims.
Matt Trissel, the fullback, offset. Cedric Benson, the tailback. Benson took the deep handoff into the end zone. Touchdown, Texas.
What? You run it to the right side. Mike Williams does a great job. The tight end to that side, Mike Jones, who'd been knocked out earlier in the game by Jay Brooks. And Mack Brown, who's been recruiting guys like Mike Williams for a long time because of their athletic ability as big men, it pays off for him.
Dusty Mangum puts Texas back up by 7. 10th rushing touchdown of his freshman season for Cedric Benson. That's a Texas freshman record. Emma Horn lead by a touchdown. Cedric Benson, a 5-yard touchdown run to put Texas back up by 7. 48 yards rushing in this quarter for Cedric Benson to move ahead of the legendary Earl Campbell in his second on the freshman rushing list, trailing only his idol now, Ricky Williams. In Texas history, David Pino's kickoff down to Terrence Thomas. Flag thrown from a long way down the field as Thomas went down at 24. Cole Trahan with another special teams tackle. And this A&M offense doesn't need any handicaps, but there's another already going into the brisk wind. They'll have to start from inside the 20-yard line. If time permits, stay tuned for the Thrifty Car Rental postgame report.
Holding on the return team, 10-yard penalty, first down.
John Saunders and Terry Bowden with scores and highlights. And of course, Nebraska and Colorado for the Big 12 North title and a berth in the conference championship game coming up next here on ABC Sports.
And as Mark Ferris runs out, some adjustments need to be made because they're into the wind. R.C. Slocum told Leslie at halftime that they wanted to take advantage of the wind at their backs, but now that they're into the wind, you have to be very, very careful. Any long throws, outcuts, anything like that, Ferris has to get a good spiral on the ball so it doesn't float.
From the 14-yard line, first and 10. Ferris dumps it short. He had a lot of time, but couldn't find anybody deeper downfield. Dwayne Goins for a gain of two, his first catch of the day. The sophomore from Lamarck, Texas, tackled by Everett Rawls.
The other thing A&M can start getting going, you know, they had Keith Joseph running pretty hard earlier, but I don't know that play action really becomes a factor right now. Texas's defense is going to have their ears pulled back, rushing up the field, maybe some type of late developing draw to get back the rush of Texas.
Four receivers spread the formation. An inside handoff, and he is stopped. Joseph barely had the handoff when he ran into Corey Redding and a host of Longhorns. Jermaine Anderson, senior from Texas City, backup defensive lineman, also in on the play.
And it's the corner blitz by Carl Reese that does this play in. Also a great play up front by Jermaine Anderson. He probably would have made the tackle even without that corner blitz, but Carl Reese changing some things up, the defensive coordinator from Texas. He can have some fun now.
Under 6 minutes remaining. Loss of three on the last play, third down and 11. Harris out of the gun, a five-man rush by the Longhorns. Lots of contact. Is it caught? Yes, what a catch. Terrence Murphy with Quentin Jammer all over him made the catch, and now the question is it a first down? It's very close. It is a first down for Texas A&M.
First down. Terrence Murphy, who hadn't played wide receiver at any level before he came to campus here this August, had to fight off the coverage by Jammer, which could not have been any better, but worked so hard during the summer. He moved into an apartment here in College Station so that he could learn the craft, worked every day with Mark Ferris, running routes, catching the ball. And Ferris, at one point, told him, calm down, everything's going to be okay. Said he actually started to bug me a little bit.
Murphy was a quarterback in high school. Third catch of the day for Murphy. Ferris running out of time, needs to get rid of it, throws it away. Tyrone Jones applying the pressure on Ferris. ABC Sports Thanksgiving Feast presented by Siemens continues tomorrow at 1 Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. Ohio State takes on Marquise Walker, number 10 Michigan, then 8 Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. It's the highly anticipated rematch, number 11 Washington, number 2 Miami. Some of you will see Notre Dame take on number 9 Stanford. Notre Dame needs to win out to be bowl eligible, with Stanford and Purdue left. Second and 10, Aggies at their own 24. 5:19 remaining fourth quarter. Texas leads by 7. Then a five-man rush. Made by Greg Porter. He's out to the 29-yard line. We'll mark him down to the 28 in the arms of D.D. Lewis.
Carl Reese, the defensive coordinator from Texas, changing up a lot of the different looks. That time, rush 3, drop 8, used a line stunt up front to try to get some kind of pressure on to Mark Ferris, but because of the drop eight, Ferris not able to find a thing and had to run over to the side and find Porter late.
Third down and six. They converted the third down a moment ago on the nice catch by Murphy. Ferris with time running out of it. He is dropped back of the 25-yard line. Tyrone Jones with the third sack of the day for the Longhorns.
This one was set up by Maurice Gordon, Sean. He's played a great ball game. Right here in the middle, a great spin move on Whitley, the guard. Flushes Ferris out of the pocket, but Gordon a little undersized in there in the middle. They had a couple of big guys, Sean Rogers and Casey Hampton, they had to replace, and he's really stepped up and played well today.
Skate. Punt buffeted by the wind, and Basher ran up to make a fair catch at the 50-yard line. Great field position for the Longhorns. Any kind of points on the board now could be fatal to A&M. Texas hoping for its 10th win of the season. It'll be the first time since 95 and just the third time since 1983 that the Horns would have won 10 in a season if they can pull this one off, leading by a touchdown. Benson runs straight ahead for three. Amon Simon made the tackle. Speaking of Cedric Benson, he is the subject of this Pacific Life game summary.
And all this productivity in the fourth quarter has come over the right side, and Mike Williams, the right tackle, paving the way. Cedric Benson, early in the game, could find no running room. The defensive front for A&M doing a great job getting penetration, but that has not been the case of late.
3:22 left. Two timeouts remaining for A&M. Benson couldn't break free from the tackle of Jay Brooks. Come on, Simon helped take Benson down. Gain of a yard. Third down and six upcoming.
And you're at the point where even at third and six with the wind at your back, don't want to do anything dumb, and the way Texas's defense has played against a shorthanded A&M offense, I would think a very conservative play call is coming.
The Aggies have done a terrific job holding those big weapons, Sims, Benson, and Williams in check. Now the offense dreadful again today for the Aggies, and they're trailing 14-7.
Timeout.
And Texas uses a timeout, leaving each team with two.
ABC Sunday. He holds the.
John McDonough, Ed Cunningham, and Leslie Goodell. A record crowd of more than 87,000 on hand. And a big third down play. Mac Brown and the staff used a timeout. 2:36 left. And first down would really make things difficult for the Aggies. They keep it on the ground with Benson, and they stand him up. About 2 yards short of the first down, Brian Gamble, the first to hit him, and stand up Cedric Benson. They're in a situation, Ed, with the wind. If they could just get into field goal range, they could salt this game away in all likelihood. But three and out, then they'll try to pin the Aggies deep. A&M down to one timeout left now with 2:29 remaining.
And with A&M now looking at Texas punting the ball with the wind at their back, not really worried about field position. It might go into the end zone. You might as well rush 10. They've got two guys out there, maybe even leave one unblocked. They have to force something to happen. Their offense struggling so bad without Jamar Taylor, their starting wide receiver, their leading wide receiver out today. Derek Farmer, their best running back and leading running back out for today. Might want to try to make something happen on their special teams like happened to them earlier in the ballgame.
The executive producer of ABC Sports is Howard Katz. Coordinating producer of college football, Bob Goodrich. Today's game produced by Bruce Clark, directed by David Kiviat. Our associate producer, Eric Posman. Associate director, Craig Bigelow. Production manager, Denise Nelson. Our entire crew appreciates Denise's efforts in putting together our Thanksgiving dinner last night. Technical manager, Jim Viola. Technical director, Beth Tora. Computer statistician, Jason Headings. The pooch punt by Bradford. And it is bobbled. And free at the 11-yard line, and the Aggies got it back. Mickey Jones couldn't catch it, and he's very fortunate that Adam Black recovered the muff.
Back there all by himself because they did come on a rush. Took his eye off at the last second. What a nice job of coverage that time by Irvis Hill. Made Mickey Jones just a little bit nervous. He knew he didn't have any blocking set up. Took his eye off for that 1 second when it hit his shoulder pad.
They're going to make it 9 undefeated home seasons in the RC Slocum era. They're going to need a rally here with 2:21 left and one timeout. 89 yards to go into the win for an offense that has been dreadful over the last three games. Just 144 yards of offense today and 9 first downs. Harris on the roll, throws. Nice catch by Porter. They missed the tackle. Nathan Vasher didn't get Porter down right after the catch. Well, Craig made it out of bounds of the 19-yard line with a gain of 8.
Dino Babers, the offensive coordinator, going back to rolling the pocket. Maurice Gordon again from that inside defensive tackle spot, getting up the field and getting pressure on Ferris. A good athlete, minor league baseball player, able to throw the ball on the run. Not a bad job. Get the ball over to the sidelines, near the sidelines, so that when the ball is caught, they can step out of bounds.
Second and 2 from the 19. Harris locks it up. Incomplete. Intended for Mickey Jones. Roderick Babers had the coverage. It'll be third down and 2.
You mentioned how Ferris just doesn't look like the quarterback he was last year, Sean, and I agree. But when he's not getting help, this is a fade route. Why do you stop running? The ball's in the air.
Ball's coming to you?
I don't understand why Mickey Jones, in the middle of his route, when it's just a run by, throw a shake at the line of scrimmage and go to run by, why he would stop. And you start to figure out why Mark Ferris doesn't look like the quarterback he was, especially at the end of last year.
Third down and 2. They're really in four down situation now. And the pass almost intercepted by Vasher, intended for Greg Porter. Must convert. Situation for A&M on fourth down and 2 at their own 19 with 2:07 left.
Nathan Vasher really has done a fantastic job as the strong safety. You mentioned that the Texas defensive backs had Roderick Babers. His nickname was Stonehands. Well, Vasher they call the opportunist because it takes advantage of everything. But that time, the opportunity was made by great coverage by Vasher.
Oscar Fleming comes in, the running back. Harris has a lot of time. Interception off the hands of Porter to Everett Rawls, who runs out of bounds at the 12-yard line, and that should put it away for the Longhorns.
Difficult throw for Mark Ferris coming back. He looked at Greg Porter early, who was covered on a crossing route. Looked at him early, getting a little bit of separation. But again, it's Vasher running all the way across the field with the much bigger Greg Porter. And Everett Rawls is the opportunist on the Nathan Vasher pass breakup.
We can talk all we want about the lack of a supporting cast for Ferris, and it is true, a lot of young and inexperienced players in there, but he has not been sharp in recent weeks either. A 26-year-old junior quarterback. Benson trying to run out the time. Just one timeout left for A&M. Evan Haroni and Terrence Keel made the stop. We also want to thank our graphics operator, Lily Best, production assistants with our crew, Jared Boschnick, and the incomparable Rick Cushman, director of production, Bob Tom. And special thanks to our help in the booth as well, our statistician, David Corris, and our spotter, Chris Helen. Brian Gamble, slow to get up. With a win, this Texas senior class would have 37 wins. They'll be heading to a bowl game for the fourth straight year. And after winning exactly 9 each of the last 3 seasons, they're about to win their 10th this year. With a chance for 11, perhaps in a BCS bowl, Mack Brown said he knows it's very unlikely that the dominoes are going to fall in such a way that they'll get up to the top two in the BCS and play in the Rose Bowl for the national championship. It does keep their hopes of going to the Big 12 championship game alive. That would be next week, but they'll need an Oklahoma State upset at Oklahoma in Norman tomorrow for that to happen. Benson threw a big hole, driving inside the five, touchdown!
Expected a bigger game out of Cedric Benson coming in against a very tough Texas A&M defense who put up a mighty fight today. But Benson, one of those guys, the coaching staff at the University of Texas took a lot of heat that Cedric Benson did not even play against Oklahoma. They were nervous about him knowing the offense. And to be honest, they didn't know how good this young man really was. A lot of his skills don't show up in practice. He is better in games than they ever expected he would be this early.
Dusty Mangum adds the extra point, and the Texas fans, a lot of them talk about that game as if Benson had played, it was a guarantee that they were going to win against Oklahoma. And as Mack Brown said, there have been a lot of good running backs who've gone up against Oklahoma this year who haven't done very much, and that Ivan Williams, who saw the bulk of the action in that game at the tailback position for Texas, had gone into that game off a couple of 100-yard rushing games.
And in the second half, they didn't run the ball very much because they weren't being effective. They figured the best way to drop Sims back, and Sims was off his game in the second half, and you brought Brett Robbins in because he was more of the blocking back on passing situations.
I'd also like to thank the rest of our terrific technical crew away from their families on this holiday weekend to bring you the sights and sounds of this incredible venue in College Station, Texas. Just the second time since 1983 the Longhorns come to College Station and win. These two universities only about an hour and a half apart. Mack Brown said 20 million people in this football crazy state. And for this game, even if you're a Houston fan, a Baylor fan, Texas Tech, whatever your favorite school might be, all of the fans seem to pick sides when the Aggies and the Horns go head-to-head. Mangum's kickoff, run back by Terrence Thomas to the 35-yard line. Coming up next, more Big 12 action, the battle for the North Division crown. Number one, Nebraska, led by Heisman candidate Eric Crouch in that terrific defense, heading into Boulder to take on the Buffaloes, ranked number 15. It will be Bobby Pesavento, took over at midseason for the injured Craig Oaks at quarterback today for the Buffs. So stay tuned to ABC Sports as our Thanksgiving feast presented by Siemens continue.
We were talking earlier about Texas, who they would want to win that game. I think they want Nebraska in the Big 12 championship. Gives the best chance of Oklahoma losing in the Big 12 championship. And I think Texas needs a two-loss Oklahoma team for them to jump above them in the BCS. Don't know if they jump above a one-loss Nebraska team to sneak in.
Corey Redding with the sack. A loss of four back to the 30-yard line. 50 seconds left. Fourth sack of the day for the Longhorn defense. Well, A&M is going to finish the season with three straight losses to three good teams. Texas Tech and two outstanding teams, maybe the two best defenses in the country back-to-back, Oklahoma and Texas. Quentin Jammer made the tackle on Terrence Murphy. Gain to the 38. It'll be third down.
And statistically, Sean, you'd have to think that Texas will become the best defense in the country with this showing today.
They will. In terms of average total yards allowed per game, they'll move up to number one in the country. And they move to 7-1 in conference and 10-1 overall. Oklahoma with a chance to go to 7-1 and split the Big South crown. But Oklahoma would go to the conference championship game by virtue of its win over Texas if the Sooners beat Oklahoma State, as they should tomorrow. Certainly this enhances, at the very least, the Longhorns' chance of being invited to a BCS bowl game as an at-large team. 10 seconds left. Fourth down. And they convert on the completion to Mickey Jones, today's Chevrolet Players of the Game. are the defensive secondary for Texas. All of them outstanding, two interceptions. And Babers had a blocked punt. And Gerard Penwright leading that A&M defense. He had eight tackles. And was in the backfield providing a lot of pressure on Chris Sims all day long. In recognition of their efforts, Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund. Well, A&M fighting to the finish, uses a timeout.
Quentin Jammer, a guy that we didn't bring up very much today, Sean. There was really only one time that they threw to his side, and Terrence Murphy made a spectacular catch on a nice throw by Mark Ferris. But Jammer, 6'1", over 200 pounds. He is built so strong in his upper body. You wonder if the NFL looks at him, although a great cornerback taking nothing away, that he might project to more of like a strong safety because of his build in the NFL. Penwright, a guy that they had to get involved. He'd gone three games without a sack. They needed pressure. They got it from him today. And take your hat off to Mike Hankwitz and his group. The Wrecking Crew stood up to that name today with their effort.
Ferris got away. This will be the last play of the game, and it is a duck up for grabs and incomplete. The final score, once again, Texas 21, Texas A&M 7. ABC Sports is online at ESPN.com, keyword ABC Sports. Coming up next, ABC Sports Thanksgiving Feast, presented by Siemens, continues with another Big 12 showdown as number one Nebraska travels to Colorado. This is ABC Sports, continuing the tradition of excellence. Now let's join John Saunders in Times Square Stadium.
First to call it.